Hey everybody, Dylan here. Welcome to my Hearthstone Knights of the Frozen Throne set review. We're going to go through every single card in the expansion and we're going to give it a rating on a scale from 1 to 5. 1 meaning that the card is complete garbage and is unlikely to be played anywhere under any circumstances, except perhaps as the result of an unlucky card generation effect. 2 stars means that the card is almost useless, but might appear in some fringe decks or decks that are made by people who are better at Hearthstone than me. 3 stars indicates a decent card and has a small chance of appearing in a high level deck and is very likely to be the enabler or to appear in a fringe deck or a tech deck that is specifically a meta counter. 4 stars is a solid, really good card that you're almost certain to see in at least one high level deck. And 5 stars is, of course, your super bombs, your cards you're going to see all over the place, multiple major archetypes are going to play them, and you're going to lose to them a lot. In addition to these 5 stars, some few cards I'm actually going to award my silver design star. Now, the star doesn't actually indicate how good the card is in terms of winning games or its impact mechanically. Rather, this delineates what I think are cards that are well designed, which is to say that they provoke interesting decisions, that they're elegant, that they connect the theme with their mechanics very well, or that they otherwise stand out among their peers in terms of just being a really well-designed card from kind of an artistic angle. So without further ado, let's move right into the neutral cards. All right, for our first neutral card, we have Acherous Veteran. This is a 1-mana 2/1 with a battle cry of give a minion +1 attack. Now, this card is obviously comparable to something like Abusive Sergeant. However, it has a couple of key differences. First of all, it obviously has 2 attack itself, like the pre-nerf version of Abusive Sergeant. And also, the attack bonus from Acherous Veteran is not an until end of turn effect. It's a permanent +1 attack. The cases in which that's relevant, not necessarily a very large number, but there are times when it'll let you squeak out an extra 1 or 2 damage, and 1 or 2 damage can sometimes be the difference between a win or a loss when you get to the end of a game when you're playing a heavy aggro deck. I'm going to give this card 4 stars. I think you're going to see it in basically any minion-oriented aggro deck. So decks like Token Druid, decks like Zulok, if we see them, maybe even Pirate Warrior, you'll see this card in there. It has the ability to trade up into 3/2s, has the ability to enable your 1/1s to trade up into 3/2s, has the ability to let your 1/3s trade and live with 2/2s, has a lot of flexibility, very useful, and a 2/1 for 1 is always just a fundamentally decent card. So yeah, 4 stars on Acherous Veteran. All right, next up we've got Bloodworm. This is a 5-mana 4/4 neutral beast with lifesteal. This card is unlikely to see a lot of play in Constructed, although I think it will be decent in Arena, and I think it might see some fringe play in decks like Singleton decks if those happen to come up, specifically Warlock Singleton if somehow that becomes a deck again, or in Wild if they want some extra healing, this card might be able to sub in. If it fights something twice, it's the same as a healbot, except that it was a 4/4 instead of a 3/3. If you somehow get it to fight extra times, then, you know, wowzers, it's worth even more. There's a small chance that something like Rogue might play this too, simply because they don't have a lot of options for lifesteal. But overall, a 4/4 for 5 really isn't very competitive. It just loses on the board and rarely is going to be able to get that repeating value. And so we're going to give that 2 stars. I almost gave it 1 star. We're going to give it 2 stars just because it is a neutral life gain option. And those always have a base level potential because there are classes that desperately need it. And there's always a chance that someone's going to pull this in a kind of unexpected way. So yeah, 2 stars. All right. Bone Mare is a 7-mana 5/5 neutral creature that has a battle cry, give a friendly minion +4/+4 and taunt. Obviously, this is a complete arena bomb. My ratings are from a Constructed perspective, but this one bears notation. This card is going to kick your ass in arena so many times, and you're going to kick people's ass in arena with it so many times. I'm going to go ahead and predict right now, this is going to get a appearance reduction nerf in the same way that Flamestrike did. There's just no way this card can be allowed to exist as a neutral common in arena at a standard appearance rate. Now, that being said, in Constructed, I think this is a 2-star card. The fact of the matter is that it's a card that is very, very bad when you have no minions on the board. And unfortunately, that's a much more frequent occurrence in Constructed, especially in the current meta. So yeah, I'm going to give this two stars. Despite its potential, it potentially is a 9/9 for 7, which is pretty decent, but it is going to be a 5/5 for 7 that doesn't really impact the board in a proactive way too often for it to be included in any major decks is my prediction. 5 mana, Cobalt Scalebane. He's a 5/5 dragon, neutral minion. At the end of the turn, you give a random friendly minion +3 attack. Obviously one other than him. So this card is basically Master Swordsmith, but way stronger because he's a dragon. It's got a competitive stat line. It's a 5/5 for 5, which is only one down from your standard stat line of a 5/5 for 6. And the effect is always going to proc at least once if you have a friendly minion. +3 attack is really no joke. As a result, I'm going to give this card 3 stars. It has a somewhat immediate effect on the board in some circumstances. It has a respectable body, and it has one of the best tribal tags you can possibly have, which is dragon. The only thing that really drags it down is that there's only one major dragon oriented deck in meta right now, which is Dragon Priest, and it's actually not terribly great. And it would have to compete for that 5 slot with Draken and Operative, which is unfortunately just not a comparison for Mr. Scalebane here. That being said, he's still a dragon with a respectable body and a respectable effect. There's always potential that someone will find space for him, especially if we see a return of combination Reno Dragon Priest with some of the cards that we've seen in this expansion, plus Kazaka still being in standard. That is possible. And if you see him anywhere, I think you're going to see him in Singleton Dragon Priest. Next up, we've got Dead Scale Knight. He's a 1/1 Murloc for 1 with lifesteal. This card is garbage. 1 star. Just don't use it. There's no deck that wants this over something like Argent Squire. Argent Squire is effectively 2/1s. This is never going to be relevant. The lifesteal that it gives you is never going to be good enough. And the fact that he's a Murloc really doesn't matter, because there's no Murloc deck that needs the extra 1 drops. Like, Murloc Paladin is cool, but I don't think it's going to play this guy. It's gotten too many other really excellent cards in this expansion, and it's got plenty of really good 1 drops already. I don't think you're going to see Dead Scale Knight at all. Total garbage. 1 star. Okay, next up, we've got Deathspeaker. Deathspeaker is a 3-mana, 2/4 with a battle cry, give a friendly creature immune this turn. Now, a lot of times, this is basically just going to read, give a friendly creature divine shield, but it goes away at the end of the turn. Sometimes, very rarely, if you have a Wind Fury minion somehow, it could be way better. There's weird meme dream combos with Giant Sandworm and this, where you play this on Giant Sandworm and it can attack an infinite number of times and just kill all the guy's minions, and that's cool. But in general, you're not really going to get that. However, even just the text, gain divine shield until end of turn, is still really good on a 2/4 for 3. I mean, Paladin has played it on a 2/2 for 2 in the history of the class. It's played it competitively in some cases. This is a 2/4 for 3, get 2 more stats for 1 more mana, a technically better effect, although technically worse in some ways as well. I think what you're going to see a lot is you're going to play this on a 2/3 or on a 3/2 or whatever, and you're going to bounce it into something, and you're basically just going to have this thing says, you know, battle cry, a friendly minion can't attack this turn, destroy an enemy minion. That's pretty good. As a result, I'm going to give it 3 stars. I don't think there's a lot of decks that are going to want that sort of weird tempo value thing and on such a non-aggressive body. But hypothetically, if tempo decks do kind of come and become much more prominent, there could be a place for Deathspeaker in those decks. Fallen Sun Cleric. This is a 2/1 for 2. Give a friendly minion +1/+1. This is just a kind of derivative card from Shattered Sun Cleric. Obviously, Shattered Sun Cleric is a 3-mana, 3/2. This is a 2-mana, 2/1. So you're losing 1 mana, you're losing 2 stats. However, I actually think this is going to be better than Shattered Sun Cleric. The big weakness of Shattered Sun Cleric, of course, is that it's a 3/2. While it does have a proactive effect on the board, it can be traded into by 1 drops that are 2/1s. This one, because it's a 2 drop, you don't care as much if it's traded into by a 1/1, and it can trade up into 3/2s in much the same way, while still having a proactive effect, such as allowing a 1/1 to trade up into a 2/2, or transforming a 3/2 into a 4/3 so that a 2/2 can't trade into it. I don't think this card is amazing by any means. I'm going to call it 2 stars, but hypothetically there could be a deck that could slot this in somewhere. All right, next up we've got Grave Shambler. This is a 4/4 elemental for 4 mana, and whenever your weapon is destroyed, you get +1/+1. So obviously the dream with this is that you drop this on turn 4 in Rogue or Warrior, and then you swing with your 1 durability weapon, and then bam, I just got a 5/5 for 4. Woo, look at me. And it's an elemental. That's pretty cool. It's 1 attack better than a Yeti, which, I mean, Yeti is a card that is always good. Like, there's a baseline goodness to a 4/5. So a 5/5 can beat up other 4/5s and come out, and that's kind of cool. But I just don't think there's a lot of situations in which you're going to be able to live the dream in a way that's truly impactful. As a result, I'm going to give this card 2 stars. It's just not unfair enough. Okay, next up we have Grim Necromancer. This is a 2/4 4/4 that has a battle cry of summon 2/1/1 skeletons. So overall, you're getting a 4/6 worth of stats on a 4-cost minion. So it's slightly above curve. It's one health more than Yeti. More vulnerable to AoE as always. I think this deck, this card might actually get play in something like Token Druid or Token Shaman because it does generate 3 bodies. It gives you a ton of extra value with things like Mark of the Lotus, Power of the Wild, and Bloodlust. As a result, I'm going to give this card 3 stars. There's a small chance that it'll see play in some of those top tier decks. There's an even smaller chance that it'll see play in some other fringe deck I haven't predicted. But anytime you are able to reliably generate above curve stats, your card has potential to be good, and it has synergy with existing archetypes. So yeah, 3 stars. Okay, next up we have a really weird card. This is Hildenir Frost Rider. He's a 4/4 for 3, but as a battle cry he freezes all your other minions. This guy is probably a more playable version of Ticking Abomination, which you'll see in a little bit. But unfortunately, I think he's just not strong enough. He's only 1 mana better than your kind of standard vanilla 3-mana 3/4, and the battle cry totally negates any board momentum and advantage that you have on your own side. So the only deck that would play this guy is someone who really specifically wants a very potent tempo minion on turn 3, but doesn't intend to fight for the board turn 1 and 2, which is just strange. Hypothetically, you can follow up like trading and board clearing with your opponent, but that's it doesn't really fit in with anything. It's a valuable card that doesn't seem to actually go well with decks that would value what it's good at. I am, however, going to give this one a silver design star because it's one of those cards that you see it and you kind of think like, what deck does want this? It challenges you a little bit and it's kind of interesting to try to find somewhere where it fits. And hypothetically, someone does find where it fits and then they have a 3-mana 4/4, which is by no means a bad card. Unfortunately, overall, I'm going to have to give it 2 stars. I think you could hypothetically see it pop up in a tempo deck, but it's probably just not good enough. Necrotic Geist. This is a 6-mana 5/3, and whenever one of your other minions dies, you summon a 2/2 ghoul. This card is absolute nonsense garbage. Cult Master is a 4/2 for 4 that gives you a much more valuable effect of drawing cards, and she doesn't get played, so there's no universe in which a 5/3 for 6 gets played. What's going to happen is you're going to play this, they're going to trade a 3/2 into it, or they're going to frostbolt it, you're going to lose 6 mana, and then you're going to lose the game. So yeah, this is an unmitigated 1-star card, complete nonsense, utter garbage, dust it, don't look at it, pray you never get it. It's terrible. Okay, Night Howler. He is a 3/4 for 4. Whenever this minion takes damage, gain +2 attack. So this is basically a much better version of Enrage. It's like a Mani Berserker, but at a lower mana cost and a more intrinsically competitive stat line. Probably nowhere near good enough constructed, although I think this card will actually be quite good in Arena. I'm going to give it 2 stars just because it does have the fundamental power level that means it could fit in somewhere, maybe in the Warrior Whirlwind-Arama deck that seems to be strongly pushed by the design of the cards in this expansion, but overall I don't think it's strong enough to really make an appearance anywhere. Okay, Skellamancer. This is a 2/2 for 5 with a death rattle of if it's your opponent's turn, summon an 8/8 skeleton. This card is terrible. It's a 2/2 for 5 that your opponent can just ignore because it's a 2/2. If you had some way to make it bigger, then it would be scary because they would have to remove it and then you'd get an 8/8, which is cool. But you could also have just made a decent minion bigger to start with and probably just gotten an 8/8 that way, maybe even with some positive effect or something like that. So yeah, Skellamancer is just too finicky to be good. He's a 1-star card, to be certain. However, I'm also going to give this one the silver star, much like the Frost Rider. He kind of just screams to be experimented with. And, you know, you look at him and you think, oh wow, this is crazy tech against Doomsayer. If they play a Doomsayer and I play this, I have an 8/8 after their Doomsayer. How good is that? And, you know, honestly, that is pretty good. Is it worth 5 mana? Is it worth a slot in your deck when not everyone you fight is going to play Doomsayer? Those are the hard questions. But there's a certain cool factor to getting an 8/8 if you manage to work this out. You know, if you manage to find a way to trigger him, he's a 10/10 for 5. That's amazing. So like the Frost Rider, he doesn't have a place to belong and it doesn't work out that way, but it's cool design because it makes you think. And if anyone ever did manage to solve the puzzle, you know, and break that open, it would be a really good card. Snow Flipper Penguin. He's a 1/1 for 0. He's a beast. He's extreme. He's ice boarding. He's 1 star. Don't play him. Spellweaver, this is a 4-4 for 6 with spell damage plus 2. This is only the second spell damage plus 2 card ever printed. Unfortunately, it is even worse than the other one. This is a 1-star card. It's way too slow. You can't combo it with things very effectively because it costs 6 mana. You know, you could play this and then Frostbolt and do 10 damage, or you could just play Pyroblast and do 10 damage, or you could play Fireball, Frostbolt and do 15. Evolved Kobold had a little bit more potential because it was a lower mana cost. This has a bigger body, but that doesn't matter because you're playing it for the spell damage, you're not playing it for the 4-4 for 6. And unfortunately, it's just too expensive to be effective. Okay, Sunborn Valkyr. This is a 5-4 for 5 with Battlecry, give adjacent minions plus 2 health. So if you have two minions and you're able to play her between the two of them, she's kind of like a 5-8 for 5. Which is pretty decent. However, she's a little bit better than that because what she does is she kind of spreads AoE resistance to otherwise understated minions, right? So let's say you played Serenite Chain Gang the turn before, for example. So you have 2 Zhu 3s. You play her, now they're both 2 5s, which means that they survive almost any AoE effect in the game that you're likely to see. They survive Flame Strike, they survive anything like that, which is very useful. Spreading that health around is much more useful than centralizing it onto one guy, because it lets you trade more advantageously. It lets you have more value against AoE, which is always what you're looking for with these kind of cards, because you're going to play this kind of card in an aggressive or kind of lower mid-range tempo deck where you want your guys to not just get wiped, because if they get wiped, you probably lose your momentum and then you lose the game. I'm going to give this card 4 stars, which I think is a little generous. I was kind of inclined towards 3, but I'm going to follow my gut. I'm going to say this is 4 stars. It compares favorably to Defender of Argus. It doesn't give them taunt, but it has much better native stats and it gives plus 2 health, which is often just as good as plus 1 plus 1. All right, so our next card is Tainted Zealot. It is a 1-1 for 2 with Divine Shield, spell damage plus 1, and a really, really sweet outfit. I'm just going to take a second and say that that hat is glorious. I love everything about it. I want the glove. She looks so intense. It's such a good, the art on this card really stands out to me. Unfortunately, the effect of the card does not stand out to me as much. It's a fairly hard to remove spell damage card, but the problem is that it's only a spell damage plus 1, and you would have to give up a slot and potentially draw it in a circumstance where it's not really going to do anything in order to make use of it. The best use of this, obviously, is to combo it with something like Maelstrom Portal, but at that point you're dropping a 1-1, you're dropping an Argent Squire in exchange for doing 2 damage with your Maelstrom Portal, and it just doesn't quite feel good enough. If this was a 2-1 or even a 1-2, I think it would be okay, but the problem is that I think it gets pinged down and traded out way too easily, and you'll have to combo it with a spell damage card, which means you're never going to play it on turn 2 anyway, and leaving turn 4 or whatever with just a 1-1 Argent Squire is not very good. All right, Tuskar Fisherman, very similar to the Tainted Zealot. It's a 2-3 for 2 with Battlecry, give a friendly minion spell damage plus 1. I think this is 1 star better. This is a 3-star card entirely because it's a 2-3 for 2. And River Crocolisk isn't great, but River Crocolisk plus something is often good enough. So I think if you're in Shaman, again, you can, you know, turn 4 Fisherman on another guy and then Maelstrom Portal for 2 and get a guy out of that is probably, it's a lot better than Tainted Zealot, right? You basically end up with a River Crocolisk instead of even ending up like with an Argent Squire to compare it with Tainted Zealot. So as a result, I think this is a 3-star card instead of a 2-star card. I think you might maybe see it in some deck like Control Shaman if it happens. Still relatively unlikely, but has a lot more potential than Tainted Zealot. Okay, Venomancer. This is a 2-5 for 5 with Poisonous. It has a secondary effect of if you put this in your deck, your win rate goes down by 20%. This is a 1-star card. It is not very good at all. It's just a 2-5. It's going to get traded into by a 5-5 if you're lucky, or by a 5-1 if you're unlucky, or it's just going to get killed with a spell and then you're going to take 12 damage to face because the other guy's board is actually good and it isn't made of 2-5 guys. Terrible card. Don't play it. We have Rhyghoul. This is a 3-1 for 3 with Death Rattle. If it's your opponent's turn, summon a 2-2 ghoul. Like all the other if it's your opponent's turn, do so-and-so cards, I'm very leery about this. I'm going to give it 2 stars because I think it's fun. Fundamentally, just a 3-1 for 3 that your opponent's going to ignore until a situation in which it's trivial for them to clear a 2-2. The problem with this card is that, yes, while it's hypothetically a 5-3 for 3, and that's like, oh my god, it's so good stats. Oh, it's really good. A good card. But the problem is that four of those stats are completely at your opponent's mercy as to when they appear. You don't get them when you need them. You don't get them when you want them. So entirely half of this card's 8 points worth of stats are up to your opponent. So of course they're going to wait to ping it until they have an Arcanomancer, and they're going to go ping, and then they're just going to kill your Arcanomancer. If they don't do that, you have a 3-1, and if you trade it into the Arcanomancer, you don't get the 2-2, at which point you just played a Wolf Rider without charge. So good job there. I'm actually going to give this 1 star. Ignore what I said a second ago. This card is garbage. Okay, Wicked Skeleton. That's a 1-1 for 4 that gains a +1/+1 for each minion that died this turn. Much like other cards in this vein that get really good based on a bunch of people being dead, this card is terrible. Flesh Eating Ghoul is a 2/3 that gets +1 and is in a battle cry and can eat minions as they die, and nobody's ever played that in a competitive deck in the last 3 years, so certainly nobody is going to play Wicked Skeleton. There is no deck that just murders so many minions all at once that it can play this and get a really big minion that can also afford to play a 1-1 for 4 potentially. It's just ridiculous. This card is 1 star. If I did 0 stars, I would give this 0 stars. This card is trash. Booty. Booty. And our last common is Wretched Tiller. This is a 1-1 for 1 that whenever this minion attacks, deal 2 damage to the enemy hero. So obviously the comparison here is with Leper Gnome. Leper Gnome obviously is a 1-1 that death rattles to deal 2 damage. So if you attack with this guy one time exactly and then he dies, that is Leper Gnome. If you manage to attack with him twice, it's now, there's not another card that does that. It's 4, 5, 6 damage for 1 mana. You're going to see this in Zoo. I think you're going to see this in Aggro Druid. It'll probably replace some of the 1-1, the 1 drops in Aggro Druid. I'm actually going to give this 4 stars. This is another bold one, one that I stand by nonetheless. I think this card is great. I think it's deceptively good. It doesn't impact the board, but it just gets you so much value that it'll get you to the point where your mid-game reach can take you the rest of the way in a deck like Shaman or Druid. I think this card is actually really good. 4 stars.